What'd you think of Gracie?
I thought she was a great ride. A definite difference between her and Dodger. Right away when I sat on her, I was like, oh my gosh. Just that her barrel is different and the way she carries herself is different. So right away I felt the difference.
Which one feels more comfortable to you?
I would say Dodger. Okay. I felt like there was more underneath me and my legs wrapped around him, his barrel, better than been on Gracie.
Yeah, and I'd have to say just watching you ride both horses, I think that your body proportions and all that are a little bit better suited to Dodger. Dodger's probably an inch bigger than she is. And a half an inch or an inch makes a huge difference in a horse. People don't realize what a big difference a half inch makes. But I think for the most part, people tend to buy horses that are way too big. You're very long-legged, and I think what you're feeling is you've got more leg on Dodger than
I
you
do
on her. So height is something definitely to consider, the horse and matching the height of the rider to the horse. Also, in terms of doing cow work and reining and that kind of stuff, we want a smaller horse. The smaller horses are more agile and they're able to move around a little bit big. Dodger's a little bit big for just a straight cow horse. Most of the cutters you see are smaller even than Gracie. So, but as an all-around horse, I think he's just a fine size. So just something to think about in terms of your school horses too is the size is definitely important. Fear is directly correlated to the size of a horse. The higher you are off the ground, the more fear is involved. So if we can find the shorter horses, people are going to be more comfortable.
Okay.
For children, you want to make sure the leg of the rider comes at least 2/3 of the way down the barrel. So if you're looking at school horses for children, you probably want to be looking at some smaller horses.
Right, so they're not too... Yeah. Too large.
On the other hand, you're going to have bigger people too, heavier people. The rider should not exceed 20% of the weight of the horse. So that means a 1,000-pound horse can manage a 200-pound rider. Now, he can manage a lot bigger rider than that, actually. That's the worst-case scenario, would be an unbalanced rider on a small horse. So in the worst-case scenario, the rider shouldn't exceed 20% of the weight of the horse. So.
Okay.
And the fact of the matter is our population's getting bigger and heavier all the time, so people are having to go to heavier horses
just to make sure that that's safe for the horse as well.
Yeah. I think another really important thing is age. For the most part, older's better. When I'm looking for horses in my horse sales program, I rarely look at a horse that's under 10 years old. Because to have the amount of training and experience and seasoning and all that, you're looking at least a 10-year-old horse. So
okay.
I like to look at horses in that 10 to 15-year-old range that have had really good handling and training all their lives. I'm not too interested in horses that have been raised and trained by amateurs because generally they have bad habits, bad manners that are really ingrained in them. If you can find horses like these, both these horses just by coincidence are 14 years old. They've had a lot of good training and handling, a lot of life experience. They've been hauled here, done that, have been all over the country. So that kind of experience is really valuable. And you can never, you can always buy training and experience cheaper than you can put it on a horse. So if I buy a young horse that still needs training, I'm looking at anywhere from $800 to $1,000 a month. So that adds up.
It does.
So I'm a lot better off going out, finding that older horse. Maybe he's a little past his prime in terms of his show career, but he's still got, you know, these horses still have 10, 15 years of really good riding left on him.
You have that experience and training.
Yeah.
So temperament-wise, is there something I should know between the mare and gelding? Is there a big difference? Is there?
Yeah, and you know, this little mare here is generally I stay away from mares, but there's always exceptions to rules. This little mare is just like any gelding you ever rode. She's mellow, she's steady, she's got a good solid temperament. The main difference between mares and geldings is that in the herd, in the natural herd, mares are more relationship-oriented than geldings are. There's two types of herds in the wild. There's broodmare bands and there's bachelor bands. And the bachelor bands consist of bachelor stallions that don't have their own mares. But they're not a bonded band of horses. They're a herd of convenience in a way. They're only there because they rely on the safety of the herd, there's safety in numbers. Any one of those stallions would walk away from that herd without looking back if he could get his own mare. But in the broodmare band, those are bonded horses. Mares form bonds with other horses. And so what that means is, in terms of a mare, and some people are mare oriented, some are gelding oriented. Geldings, they go to work every day. They're the same every day. They punch in, they punch out. You can make a lot of mistakes on a gelding, and the next day he's forgotten about it. But a mare wants to form a bonded relationship, and that can be a good thing or that can be a bad thing. Mm-hmm. Basically the old time saying is a mare will work 10 times harder for you than a gelding ever will, as long as you're on her good side. And if you're not on her good side, she'll work 10 times harder against you than a gelding ever will. And so I think you just kind of have to know that about yourself. Now, for your lesson horses, you definitely want to go with the geldings. And here's the reason why. Because mares want to form that bonded relationship, they want to know who their rider is. They want to trust their rider. They want to test their rider. So mares have trouble switching riders all the time. They start doing more testing of riders than a gelding will. Okay. When you look at most lesson operations or trail riding operations, they're generally all geldings because of that. A gelding will switch riders all the time, not worry about it. Mares, it stresses them out, and then they start kind of testing and provoking riders a little bit. So they won't last really long, very long in your lesson program.
They'll be stressed the whole time probably.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's just hard on them. But on the other hand, if what you want is that really strong bonded relationship, maybe you're a mare person. So, but definitely you want to look at, really get a feel for that horse. Like I said, this little mare has very little, if any, marish behavior. She really acts more like a gelding than a mare. So there are mares out there, and there's geldings out there that are, just like a mare. They're herd bound and pissy, mm-hmm. and all that. So, those are just general guidelines.
Okay. And when I'm ready to purchase a horse, how would I go about doing that when I've found the horse that I really want?
Okay. Well, first of all, price is generally a flexible thing. I would not, if let's say you're looking on a website or you're in the newspaper or whatever at horses for sale, mm-hmm. I would assume that the price is not set in stone. And so if my budget is I'm going to spend $6,500, I'd go look at a $10,000 horse, because you don't know what the circumstances are. How long has the horse been for sale? How desperate are they for the money? On the other hand, sometimes people say the price is not negotiable. When I sell horses, I tell people right up front, this is the price of the horse. It's not negotiable. But you're going to ask a lot of questions. There's more information on my website that will give you a list of questions to ask, primarily, why is the horse for sale? And that's going to have to do with the price that you offer.
Okay. Great. Well, thank you, Julie.
You're
appreciate
welcome.
It. I feel I'm definitely have some tools to take out there.
Good.